He will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the laws. We enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member is to go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I am your host, Dave Bourne, and it is June 30th, 2016, and we are coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada, here at the Nonpartisan Liberty for All Media and Radio Network Studios, which is really just a room in my house, so but it is a dedicated room. So thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern. And you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com and to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, and SoundCloud, as well as the next day on Stitcher and iTunes. On Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty and self-ownership, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. And we are happy to hear from you with your comments. You can reach us at 702-470-7664 by phone. That's 702-470-7664. Or you can reach us via Skype, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Just send a contact request and your name and what you want to talk about. And you can get all of that information and more at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. Where you can also find links to all our Facebook pages and social media, as well as original articles, blogs, and other things. I'm currently working on a series on the legalization of drugs and why they should go back to how they were before 1920, and I'm on part four of that series currently, so that is out there posted under articles/blogs if you'd like to read any of those articles, along with other articles and blogs as well. So this is the second part, as we didn't get to everything yesterday and still had a lot to get to of our show on college rape, including my mind just totally went blank there. College rape, including rape culture and sexual assaults. Not that that is a funny thing, because it's not, and really where it came from, because I don't know. I do now, from all of the research I did, and I've stuffed my head with so much information in the past couple of days regarding this topic, but this was not something I knew a lot about prior to that. But there was a documentary, and that's kind of where it started, the interest in this topic, The Hunting Ground, which is a totally one-sided propaganda video that only shows it from the perspective of the women. And it doesn't show the men's or the college's perspective. There is a small short excerpt that shows men that were being raped, so, or that it doesn't actually show them being raped, but men that were raped. So it shows it from the perspective of the mostly women, but a few men, but of the victim in this case. And it's I keep kind of going back and forth on this whole thing, because you have two sides to this issue. Then you also have the government getting into it, and you have what is the responsibility of a college in this scenario. And I think there's different levels of responsibility depending upon where you live, and not necessarily where you live, but where it takes place. I don't know that the college has a, or how much of a, not guarantee, but an obligation they have to make sure things like this don't happen, because there's only so much they can do. And this is something we run into in every aspect of society. There was a couple things I wanted to talk about real briefly before we got back into this topic. But you're looking at an issue that, of course, I feel terrible for the women. On the same side, any man who's accused who did not commit sexual assault, I feel bad for them as well. I think it's definitely worse for a woman being, I mean, I guess it depends on the level of sexual assault. I mean, if it's something where somebody grabbed someone, is not as bad, obviously, as being actually raped. But any woman that's raped, I feel worse for them than a guy that is accused of rape that didn't do it, as long as he doesn't actually go to jail. You know, if he's accused of rape and before a trial happens, or even before he faces any jail time, it comes out that he didn't do it, then I would feel worse, definitely, for a woman who was raped, I mean, who had to go through that, than, you know, a guy who just had to go through a false accusation and an arrest. And not to say that that's not nothing, but if you have somebody who had to go through 20 years of prison, you know, they could end up being raped themselves. So it all depends on how far it goes. And rape is really a, I don't want to say interesting crime, but it's different than most other crimes, because most of the time, and I've come to the conclusion that these are the rapes that they're talking about, because what I did yesterday is I broke them down into, I think, five different categories, and the rapes that they're talking about are not really serial rape and those type of things, that they're talking more about them being two people being alone, alcohol being involved, and somebody may or may not be being passed out, and then what happens in that scenario. I think that is really what they're talking about, because that was a problem with this whole documentary, is they didn't get specific enough as far as I saw it. I didn't see them getting specific enough on exactly what happened in these scenarios. And I don't need to know the specifics as far as what they did, just how it got to that point. So, meaning I don't need to know if penetration took place, or it was just forced oral or whatever. I don't need to know the specific sexual act. What I mean is, what happened? Was it that the girl was passed out and she was raped? Or was it that she was alone with a guy and held down and raped or threatened that if you don't do what I want you to do, I'm gonna, you know, punch you in the face? You know, what I'm saying is, in this video, and even in most of what I saw, not everything, and we'll talk about that, but a lot of the things I came across, they just call it sexual assault. Well, this woman was sexually assaulted. Well, how was she sexually assaulted? What situation was she in? So the Stanford case, which I brought up yesterday and we'll go into detail today, that I know exactly what happened, and that was rape. It's clearly rape. There are two guys. Sorry, not the Stanford case. But that was rape clearly as well. The Vanderbilt case was what I was referring to in my head. But the Stanford case as well was clearly rape also. So these are two cases where women were passed out and it was clearly rape. There's no argument there. And they were prosecuted, even though in the Stanford case, the guy only got 6 months, and we'll get into that. But it seems like the issue that the women are talking about, where they're being ignored or it's not being addressed, is always issues that it's a guy and a girl alone and there's a lot of alcohol involved. And that seems like why they're not really coming out and saying that. The only time I'm hearing anything regarding that is when a girl is totally passed out. And most of the time when a girl's passed out, you can't prove it really unless there's a witness. And in those two cases I just mentioned, there was. One of them, there was actually video. So we'll talk about those two cases, which were terrible. And luckily, in one of them, people came along and helped with the – we'll go into that later. I don't want to ruin it up front. I want to go through the whole case altogether. So, but like everything in society or the majority of things, I mean, you can't prevent everything. So currently they're talking about, of course, terrorism, and – which, again, you look at the amount of what they call terrorism. I don't know what the definition of even terrorism is anymore, because none of these, if you believe the narratives of the government, which, of course, I don't, there was only one terrorist event that was connected directly to a terrorist organization. And there were, they want to call it three, okay, fine, that were inspired by Muslim radicalist groups, and that were radical Muslims that committed them. There were two shootings, and if you count the Boston bombing, which, again, I wouldn't, but if you're counting those, that's four acts of terrorism in 15 years. And then again, what do you count as terrorism? You know, shooting people and the amount of people that died, excluding 9/11. And there's no way. It's just what happened in Orlando. There's just no way that one guy could have killed that many people. I don't believe that. Whether it was the cops that shot them by accident or another shooter or whatever. And how they handle that case makes no sense. So that's just I have so many questions about that. And then in the other shooting in San Bernardino over a year ago, I think it was 17 people. That guy was just fucking nuts, is what it sounded like. But either way, and in the Boston bombing, two or three people were killed, but there were people that were seriously injured. I mean, that had limbs blown off, and it was terrible. And those people having to, you know, deal with that is just horrible. And coming out and saying that the government had something to do with certain crimes, or they're really the ones behind ISIS or anything like that, does not at all take away from how at least me personally feel for the people that were killed or injured. It's worse because the ones who are really doing it to them, they don't even know. But as far as the shootings, I don't know what happened. The Boston bombing, there's no doubt in my mind the government was involved, and same with 9/11. But those two shootings, the only thing is in the Orlando shooting is that one person killing that many people. It just, in the time in between and not knowing what went on. So, but the point being that you can't be there every second unless you want to totally take away all freedom, which I believe that is their ultimate goal anyway. And at the same time, they're meeting on gun control and want to pass. I've heard a bunch of different things. I've heard banning certain weapons again and things like that, but they want to meet and come up with some bipartisan bill. And now they have, even though this guy wasn't a member of ISIS, but they have something in common where the Republicans are all anti-terrorists and terrorism is a big thing, fighting terrorism, even though, you know, there's barely any terrorism here that actually happens here. But, I mean, what's the difference really between that and a shooting somewhere? And that's the whole thing. It's just how they classify it. It's almost, it's perception. It's all perception because it's all about how they classify something and classify it as, oh, this is a terrorist attack, or this is this, or this is that. And based on that, they come to whatever conclusions they come to. But regarding things like terrorism and people that they call the quote-unquote lone wolf terrorists, where they don't know anything about them, or that, well, it's fucked up because obviously in this case they did, and they talked to him. That's why it's hard to believe. They talked to him multiple times. They talked to him a couple of days before. The same with the Boston bombing. He was connected with the CIA. He did talk to the FBI. It's like, yeah, it's just hard to believe that these guys weren't somehow connected with a government agency and didn't do it with the help of a government agency. Because look what it does. It allows them to exploit the laws and have people support them, get support from people. Yeah, let's get rid of these guns. And it does that. It brings the what ifs to reality. Because it was always though, well, what if somebody goes in a gun and grabs a gun and does this? And now it's, if it happens, then it's the, see, look, it happened. And now we need to do something about it. And then it brings a lot of those people in to support it. to me, it doesn't matter what happens. I think that you have the right to own a gun, and everybody has the right to own a gun, and everyone has a right to defend themselves. So when you go to something like rape and you look at how far are colleges to go, because the federal government has gotten involved now, which I mentioned this last night. Now, there is federal money, and this is how the federal government controls things. There's federal money. I don't know that every school gets federal money. There are private schools, but I think even the private schools get some federal money. But I don't know how much control they have over the private schools, because they're not 100% private. So they are mandating that Title IX is followed. And Title IX, it started as, from what I understand, it was about sexual harassment, and then it turned into a hostile, I was going to say hostile work environment, but it's not a work environment, but a hostile environment where women are saying that their rapist is there at college. And the federal government is saying that if they're not complying with Title IX, because that would be violating Title IX, them being in a hostile environment. And if their rapist is in the same environment that they're in, they're in a hostile environment. But what about when they don't have enough evidence to expel the alleged rapist? In that case, so what happens then? So there's like 100-something schools. I don't know how far the federal government wants to take this, probably as far as they can in controlling the schools. And they pretty much, I think, want to take over. I mean, I pretty much think they want to take over everything. But I mean, how involved should be the federal government be with colleges? And you're talking about yes, they're getting federal money, but people are paying to be there. They're over 18, the majority of them. There could be some people there that are 17. I graduated from high school, and I would have started. Well, there may not be any more, because you might have to be. I've heard that you have to be a certain age by a certain time. But I would have been 17 for a couple weeks. I took a year off. But if I didn't, I would have been 17 for a couple weeks in college. But with the exception of that, and again, I think people are starting school a little later, so that doesn't happen. Like if they're not a certain age by, you know, April or May. I think when I went to school, it was by like December of that year. So you could have somebody who was in college for 3 months at 17, but I don't think that's the case now. But I'm sure you can have geniuses, I guess, there. But with the exception of that, what responsibility do the actual schools have in dealing with rape and sexual assault and keeping people safe? And what responsibility do people have? And again, this is not blaming any victims at all, but what responsibility do people have in this is where it seems like the government and feminist organizations And anybody who is fighting for this, you know, fighting against sexual assault, which I don't have any problem with that, but they all seem to be ignoring the drinking that's going on. And it's not like, you know, I don't know what the percentage would be, but I'm sure it's a high percentage. And a lot of these are cases where they don't remember everything that happened. So it's hard to even sort all that out. Now, that's unfortunate that they don't in situations where they don't remember, and a guy gets away with rape because they don't remember enough to be able to convict him or have enough evidence to show that a girl was raped. Because as I was saying yesterday, I mean, you can't just convict somebody of rape based on the fact that somebody accuses them. And if you have no evidence, then you have no evidence. But the main thing that seems to be in all of these cases, and that's why, again, in the documentary, they seem to be leaving out a lot of details. But the major thing all seems to be that, and even some videos, some more videos that I had heard where they did mention, a girl mentioned she had like 9 shots in an hour of something. It was something strong. I don't remember what it was. So having 9 shots in an hour, now she probably can drink because she's at college, and if she had 9 shots in an hour, I assume that she's probably built up her tolerance and she can handle a lot of alcohol. But the point being is that, again, I'm not, you know, you bring this up, it's you're blaming the victim. Well, I'm not blaming the victim, but they're putting themselves in situations that if they weren't in those situations would probably, not 100% eliminate rapes on college campuses, but it probably would decrease them by a large amount. So what does the school do? So if the school is being held responsible by the federal government in this case, so do they just, if anybody is, because this is what it seems like the girls want, that if a guy is accused of rape, he's just accused, that he gets expelled from school. And that way they'll be in compliance because with Title IX, because the girl won't have to see her rapist. Now, that's fine. It works for the girl, fine. But what if she is lying? And like, we'll talk about Mattress Girl. And they're still talking about her on certain shows, like information didn't come out that pretty much proved that she was lying. But you can't just accuse somebody and then expel them and say, well, it doesn't matter that we don't have any evidence. To be compliant with Title IX, the federal government's kind of saying, well, and this is how I'm taking it. Now, I might not have enough information, but this is how it sounded. And I listened to the speech from Obama, and I'm going to play the, yesterday I played like the minute and a half one. I'm going to play the 17 minute speech from Obama about this. But it seems like that's what they want. that basically, if a guy is accused of rape, if a woman says, or sexual assault, says, oh, last night, you know, that guy came over and, you know, touched me and he didn't have my permission and I want him expelled because I don't want to run into him. I don't want to see him. And I have that right based on Title IX. So they say, okay, and they just expel him. Because all of these stories, and this is why I don't think they told most of the details in the documentary, the ones that I heard, they sound pretty fucking bad. Where there was one where a girl was friends with this guy, and she chose to stay at his house. I don't know if I told this last night or not. I don't believe I did, but I could have. That instead of taking a cab home, she chose to stay at his house. And she was drinking. And she said that she trusts him more than the cab driver and didn't want to take a cab home because she didn't feel safe. But she felt safe with this guy. Now, I'm not saying that this guy didn't sexually assault her. He could have. But what I'm saying is it already sounds bad because you're drunk. And you're staying at this guy's house who you already trust. Now, just because you trust somebody does not mean that they can't fuck you over. And I've known a lot of people who have fucked me over. So, and especially when it comes to guys and girls, it doesn't mean anything. So I'm not saying that in this case nothing happened, but it just sounds bad right away. Just like the girl that took, well, I took 9 shots in an hour. Just taking 9 shots in an hour, how can you prove or trust even your memory as to what happened? I mean, so I don't see this ending without fraternities changing a lot of their rules, and they are at fault, I would say, that definitely they set up an environment. This is what it seems like from the information that I have seen. Again, I've never been to a fraternity party. I'm not an expert in any of this. But from what I have seen from the research I have done, and that's really all I can do, it seems like they create this environment. It definitely does. And that they use it to their advantage because they know that, okay, a girl who's wasted and who was wasted, who's going to believe her? Now, I'm not saying that I don't believe them, and I'm not saying that it's their fault, because it's not their fault. If somebody actually did something, it's 100% the fault of the person who sexually assaulted them. What I am saying is it kind of almost throws out anything you were going to say or proof of what happened out the window to an extent. Because if you black out, and I'm not talking about pass out, I'm talking about blackout, and you don't remember what happened, how are you going to know? And in one of these cases, the girl didn't know. If it wasn't for videos and actually something else that happened, the girl wouldn't even have known. So I'm sure there's even more girls that get sexually assaulted that don't even remember. And you can't put yourself in that situation. And if you're going to drink, make sure you're with a friend or a couple friends that don't drink, or, you know, only have a couple drinks, or, but this getting totally wasted and then trying to talk about somebody that sexually assaulted you again. I'm not saying that it didn't happen, but it makes it harder for everybody. Because you take that to court, there's no way you're getting a conviction on that for the most part. Unless there's other evidence. If the only people there were you and the other person, and you were drinking and got wasted, and there's no physical evidence, meaning they didn't hold you down or beat you or anything like that, you can't, there's nothing that is going to, I don't even think that's enough evidence to arrest somebody. And that's really, I think, why they didn't want to go to the police, because even in the documentary, they talked about going to the school, not the police. So it's almost like they don't think it's that bad. Or there was a story where the girl didn't think she was raped until after she talked to her friends. So let me talk about the examples in the media, and then we could talk about rape culture as well as Title IX and the federal government, also California and New York. And I don't know if other states have passed these laws too, but California, it's basically you have to say yes for every little fucking thing. And if you don't, you could be charged with rape. You can't just assume that by nonverbal cues that they want to do what they're doing, which is, I don't know, it's kind of getting out of control. So first, let me talk about, since I already started to bring them up, these two cases that had to do with women passing out. And I'm sure there were a bunch more cases. I just didn't have a chance to find more. But these were national cases and recent. So there was the Stanford rape case, which I talked about. And in this case, a woman was found behind a dumpster. A guy, I don't know how he found her. He might have been walking by. This guy's a sick fuck. He's also a swimmer. And in the other case, they're athletes as well. Seems like a lot of times it's athletes. Now, I don't want to, you know, a school has, I don't know how many athletes, but they have plenty of athletes. So it's not a reflection on athletes, but it does. I think what sometimes happens is if you're a semi-famous, you know, athlete, your team's well known and people know who you are and stuff like that, and girls are throwing themselves at you, and you might have that sense of entitlement. Now, not everybody does, but I'm saying that's possible. And even if it's, you know, 1 in 5,000, I mean, there's people going through there every year, on, say, football teams with all the colleges around the country. And so you're going to find some of those type of guys in there. But it doesn't speak to anywhere near all athletes or even all football players or all of any sport, because there's so many. So within that group of so many of them, you're going to find some that are like that. But in the Stanford case, Brock Turner, a swimmer, had held her down, or not held her down. She was passed out, had pulled up her dress, and had sex with her. These two guys, I don't know if they were out were they biking? They were doing something like jogging or biking or something. And they happened to see this going on and saw that the girl wasn't really moving. Like, it looked like she was passed out. So they had stopped, and I guess he seen them and ran. And then they went, they chased after him, which is good for them, and held him down, and then called the police and waited for the police to come. So in this case, this could easily have gone another way if these two guys didn't come by. Because she was drunk and she was passed out. How she ended up passed out behind the dumpster, I don't know. And I feel bad for her and what happened to her. But if these guys didn't come by, you'd have his word against hers. Although, you know, how would you explain that one, I guess, that, oh, we went outside to, you know, because probably what he would have done is just left her there and she wouldn't have remembered what happened, most likely, and maybe she wouldn't even know. So that's what I'm saying, that by drinking that much and getting in that position of passing out, that most likely, if those guys didn't happen to come by, nothing would have happened and this guy would have got away with it. And that's fucked up. He should obviously be held accountable for what he did. Now, I guess he could have got up to 14 years. He got 6 months. And there's protests now at Stanford that over this judge who had sentenced him to get that judge out and get rid of him. And he had made some statement about ruining his life or I don't remember the exact phrase that he had used. But who gives a fuck? I mean, I would say in this case, again, not knowing all of the details, but what I do know, I mean, he should have got 10 years and served like 5. I mean, he raped a girl. Now, she was passed out. He didn't jump out with a weapon and hold her down and beat her. And to me, that makes it more serious. But, you know, I mean, this is an obvious rape. There are witnesses. There's no denying what he did. So definitely at least 5 years in jail serving that. So you would get more time. And then, and again, as I mentioned yesterday, I think the whole prison system and what I call injustice system, I don't support it at all, but I'm just basing it off of the current system that based off of what he did. Because they said he'll probably be out in 3 months. I don't know what the laws are in California as far as how much time you have to serve. But I would think you'd have to serve more. Either way, I mean, 6 months or 3 months, he's not serving that much time. I mean, to me, a day in jail is bad. But when you could have went to jail for 14 years and you're going for 6 months, you know, that's a big thing. Of course, I believe that that's a felony, so he'll be a convicted felon. But still, I mean, this girl, for the rest of her life, has to deal with, you know, being raped. And I don't know, you know, obviously I can't compare that to anything. I got jumped and robbed once by like 3 or 4 people. And that's really the only thing I can compare it to. You know, you feel like you've been had something stolen. Well, obviously, when you get robbed, you have had something stolen. So, and I can't compare that. I mean, obviously, that's totally different. That's nothing compared to what happened to this girl. But, you know, I can't really, I can just only imagine how bad she felt. So, yeah, he definitely deserved more time. And again, you got to give a lot of props to those guys that had stopped it, because they didn't have to do anything. They could have just, again, I think they were biking, but they could have just kept going and minded their business, like, you know. And I'm not somebody who, you know, I hate people getting into my business, like my neighbors and shit like that. It's like, mind your own fucking business. But there's a difference when you see something like that compared to just, you know, the nosy neighbor or the see something, say something fucking bullshit that they put out there. I think there's a difference between this and that. And I think what they did was the right thing. And, you know, I'm glad that they did that. And otherwise, the guy might have got away. Maybe they would have seen him again, but probably not. So, you know, I don't know how dark it was or whatnot. So the other case that I'm going to talk about, it's similar circumstances in that the girl passed out, but it's totally different in the level of how fucked up it was. Not that, of course, you know, what this other guy did, Brock Turner, wasn't fucked up. I mean, this was fucked up too, but this involves multiple people and a bunch of shit that just, you're just like, what the fuck are you guys doing? I don't know. So we're going to take a break. When we come back, we'll talk about the Vanderbilt case and what went on there in the case where a woman was sexually assaulted. I'm not even sure if she was raped or what specifically happened. I do know a few things that they had mentioned, but it was pretty bad. So I'm going to play this Obama speech, the whole thing. And if it gets to anything where he gets to something else, I'll either stop it or go to another clip, because I do also have the clip of the interview of one of the guys who stopped the Stanford rape. So we have that as well. And I have there's a whole bunch of clips that I have here. So, but I do want to play this. So I'll play the Obama speech, and assuming that we play the whole thing, I'll just play that. And when we come back, we'll talk about what happened with the Vanderbilt rape. So definitely check us out at Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and either give us a call, 702-470-7664, or call us via Spreaker, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All. And you can get all that at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. And we will be right back.
Folks, let me start off by telling you why I've never had a doubt about joining this man on the ticket and why I'm so proud of Valerie Jarrett and all that she does. One of the first things the president did when we took office was set up the Council on Women and Girls because he believes with every fiber in his being, as I do, that his daughters and my granddaughters are entitled to every single solitary.
And I'm going to, because it's Biden first, we're going to, we can get by.
Opportunity,
skip
my grandson
Biden.
And sons are entitled to. With to raise a hand a woman that can be taken is for a man.
And as Joe mentioned, had nobody to turn to. Joe was out there. Few people have brought Sebelius and Arne Duncan. It's preventing the outrage.
Okay, there we go. Sorry about that, but at least we'll save some time just listening to Obama's speech and not having to listen to Biden drone on there.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Thanks. Thank you. Please have a seat. Well, hello, everybody. Welcome to the White House. To all of you in my administration, the partners with the White House Council on Women and Girls, led by Valerie and Tina Chin, I want to thank all of you for being here today and for the work that you're doing every single day to advance a cause that matters to all of us. That's preventing the outrage, the crime of sexual violence in America. I especially want to thank the members of my cabinet who are here today. We've got Secretaries Chuck Hagel, Kathleen Sebelius, and Arne Duncan, as well as Attorney General Holder. And their presence here today, and the presence of so many leaders from across my administration, is a testament to how important we consider this issue and how committed we are across the entire federal government to meeting this challenge. And that, of course, includes our outstanding Vice President. Few people have brought more passion to this fight over the decades than Joe Biden. Back when a lot of people believed that domestic abuse was a private family matter and women in danger often had nobody to turn to, Joe was out there saying, this is unacceptable. This has to change. And thanks to Joe and so many others, this nation enshrined its commitment in the Violence Against Women's Act. Police officers and prosecutors got special training on domestic violence. More shelters opened across the country. A national hotline was created. And, as Joe mentioned, a cultural shift began to occur. Americans came to see how serious this problem was and how we all needed to do more to address it. And that's resulted in more hope and more safety and a new chance at life for countless women. So Joe was on the front lines on this. And you can tell his passion is unabated. And so we are very grateful for everything that you've done on this work. Thank you, Joe. Appreciate it. So I think that conviction and that passion brings us all here today, because this is not an abstract problem that goes on in other families or other communities. Even now, it's all not always talked about enough. It can still go on in the shadows, but it affects every one of us. It's about all of us. Our moms, our wives, our sisters, our daughters, our sons. Sexual assault is an affront on our basic decency and humanity. And for survivors, the awful pain can take years, even decades, to heal. Sometimes it lasts a lifetime. And wherever it occurs, whether it's in our neighborhoods or on our college campuses, our military bases, or our tribal lands, it has to matter to all of us. Because when a young girl or young boy starts to question their self-worth after being assaulted and maybe starts withdrawing, we're all deprived of their full potential. When a young woman drops out of school after being attacked, it's not just a loss for her, that's a loss for our country. We've all got a stake in that young woman's success. When a mother struggles to hold down a job after a traumatic assault, or is assaulted in order to keep a job. That matters to all of us, because strong families are a foundation of a strong country. And if that woman doesn't feel like she has recourse when she's subject to abuse, and we're not there supporting her, shame on us. when a member of our military is assaulted by the very people he or she trusted and serves with, or when they leave the military voluntarily or involuntarily because they were raped, that's a profound injustice that no one who volunteers to defend America should ever have to endure. So sexual violence is more than just a crime against individuals. It threatens our families, it threatens our communities. Ultimately, it threatens the entire country. It tears apart the fabric of our communities. And that's why we're here today, because we have the power to do something about it. As a government, as a nation, we have the capacity to stop sexual assault, support those who've survived it, and bring perpetrators to justice. And that's why last year I was proud to sign the reauthorization of the Violence Against Women's Act, which improved the support we gave to cities and states to help end sexual assault. And that includes funding to train police officers and nurses and to speed up the processing of untested rape kits so we can reduce that backlog, solve unsolved cases, get justice for victims. We pushed for the Violence Against Women Act to include more protections for immigrants, for lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender Americans, for Native Americans, because no matter who you are or where you live, everybody in this country deserves security and justice and dignity. And we have to keep reaching out to people who are still suffering in the shadows. As Commander-in-Chief, I've made it clear to our military leadership that we need to deal aggressively with the problem of sexual assault in our armed forces. It has been going on too long, and we have an obligation to protect the men and women who put their lives on the line to protect us. And Secretary Hagel and Chairman Dempsey have already taken steps to reduce violence and support those who've been harmed, but I've made it clear I expect significant progress in the year ahead. These crimes have no place in the greatest military on earth. I've directed agencies across the federal government to do more to help members of their workforce who've been assaulted. Because employers have a role to play, too. I want my administration to lead by example. That's why we're releasing a new report today that outlines all of our efforts and where we intend to do more. And I met earlier today with Secretary Sebelius, Hagel, Duncan, Attorney General Holder, as well as Vice President Biden, as well as members of my senior staff, to discuss how we implement going forward, because I want to make sure we're doing everything we can to spare another American the trauma of sexual assault. Today, we're taking another important step with a focus on our college campuses. It is estimated that 1 in 5 women on college campuses has been sexually assaulted during their time there. 1 in 5. These young women worked so hard just to get into college. Often their parents are doing everything they can to help them pay for it. So when they finally make it there, only to be assaulted, that is not just a nightmare for them and their families. It's an affront to everything they've worked so hard to achieve. It's totally unacceptable. 3 years ago, we sent every school district, college, and university that receives federal funding new instructions clarifying their legal obligations to prevent and respond to sexual assault. And we have seen progress, including an inspiring wave of student-led activism and a growing number of students who found the courage to come forward and report attacks. And that's exactly what we want them to do. And we owe all these brave young people an extraordinary debt of gratitude. But we cannot stop there. There's obviously more that we have to do to keep our students safe. And that's why here today I will sign a presidential memorandum creating the White House Task Force to Protect Students from Sexual Assault. And we're going to work with colleges and universities and educational institutions of all kinds across America to help them come up with better ways to prevent and respond to sexual assault on their campuses. And then we'll help them put those ideas into practice. Because our schools need to be places where our young people feel secure and confident as they prepare to go as far as their God-given talents can carry them. None of this is going to be easy. Some of you have worked on these issues for years. You know how long it took for our country to get to where we are now. And it didn't just take new laws. It took a fundamental change in our culture, a shift in our attitudes about how we think about sexual violence and how much we value the lives and dignity of our wives and sisters and daughters and sons. Over time, we've become a better, stronger nation for it. But now it's up to each of us, every single one of us, to keep up that momentum. We've got to keep teaching young men, in particular, to show women the respect they deserve and to recognize sexual violence and be outraged by it and to do their part to stop it from happening in the first place. Now, during our discussion earlier today, we talked about, I want every young man in America to feel some strong peer pressure in terms of how they are supposed to behave and treat women. And that starts before they get to college. So those of us who are fathers have an obligation to transmit that information. But we can do more to make sure that every young man out there, whether they're in junior high school or college or beyond, understand what's expected of them and what it means to be a man, and to intervene if they see somebody else acting inappropriately. We're going to need to encourage young people, men and women, to realize that sexual assault is simply unacceptable, and they're going to have to summon the bravery to stand up and say so, especially when the social pressure to keep quiet or to go along can be very intense. We've got to keep working with our teachers and police officers and health professionals and community leaders to search for new ways to prevent these crimes. My hope and intention is that every college president who has not personally been thinking about this is going to hear about this report and is going to go out and figure out who's in charge on their campus of responding properly and what are the best practices and are we doing everything that we should be doing. And if you're not doing that right now, I want the students at the school to ask the president what he's doing or she's doing. And perhaps most important, we need to keep saying to anyone out there who's ever been assaulted, you are not alone. You will never be alone. We have your back. I've got your back. And I promise I'm going to keep fighting for you and your families, and I'm going to keep pushing for others to step up across my administration and in Congress and in state capitals and in college campuses and on our military bases and all across our country. This is a priority for me, not only as president and commander-in-chief, but as a husband and a father of two extraordinary girls. I've often said in my travels around the world, you can judge a nation and how successful it will be based on how it treats its women and its girls. Those nations that are successful, they're successful in part because women and girls are valued. And I'm determined that by that measure, the United States of America will be the global leader. I'm grateful to each of you for making sure that happens. I'm grateful for Joe Biden for having led the charge both in Congress and in my administration on many of these issues.
You are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with your host, Dave Bourne. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. So that was the president's speech. It was a while ago. It might have been 2 years ago or maybe a year and a half ago, but it wasn't all that recent. But, I mean, it was recent, but, I mean, it wasn't like it was 6 months ago or something like that, that he had done that speech either in 2014 or the beginning of 2015. And a lot of that has to do with that the Title 19 and their filing against all these schools, and there's at least 100 schools that aren't abiding by Title 9. And you can actually look that up to get more information. Again, from what I understand, it was started in 77 and it was supposed to be for sexual harassment, from what I understood. And now it's kind of evolved into a whole bunch of other stuff. But I want to get into this Vanderbilt rape case. And this, I follow college football and I didn't hear about this, but this may have, on the videos I was looking at or listening to, I think this is rather recent. At least the videos were dated recently. So I don't know if this happened in the off season, like this has happened in the past 6 months or not. But Vanderbilt's a shitty team. They are in a probably the best, although I don't know if they were the best conference last year, but the SEC, who, you know, is usually the best conference by far in college football, but they're one of the bottom teams because they're more of a they're a better school with higher standards to get in than all the other schools like Alabama and Florida and some of those schools. Not that I'm saying those schools are bad schools or stupid or anything like that, but Vanderbilt is, from what I heard, I mean, they're up there when it comes to schools. They're one of the top 20 schools in the country is what they had said. So this is a really disturbing story of what had happened, at least what I had heard and how I understand how this happened. They had I believe it was a tight end that transferred from junior college from California. He probably, when he came to Vanderbilt, which is in Nashville, Tennessee. So people are comparing what happened in the Stanford case to this case as far as the sentencing. And you have to remember that, one, you're dealing with totally different states in Tennessee, in Nashville, and in Northern California. So that right there is just totally different. But even what happened in the case is as bad as the Stanford case is. This case is even worse just because of the multiple people involved, and the girl shouldn't have had to worry, to be honest, even though she did drink too much. She was with somebody she thought she could trust. So I think she met this guy who transferred over from junior college. He supposedly was a really good player. And that's why I think it was this year that he didn't get to play yet. But they were talking possible NFL type of player. But again, he didn't, you know, get to play yet. And that's always, you always have players in college that they think may go to the NFL that don't. And players out of high school that are going to be great college players and they're not. So you never know how he would have done at Vanderbilt. But from what I understand, he never got to play. But he must have met this girl maybe when he was touring, or she had showed him around. She was a cheerleader. So he was out with her, Brandon, the transfer. He was out with her. They went to a bar. Now, she drank a lot, but she felt comfortable and safe with him, because she had said before she knew what happened that he would never let anything happen to her. So you're looking at a case, even though alcohol was involved, this girl was with someone who she felt she could trust. So I don't know if she went out drinking with her friends, getting that wasted usually or what, but she was in a situation where I would say that situation is fine if she's with someone who she can trust, who she feels that she can trust. Obviously, this is wasn't the case, but she felt like, hey, I don't have to worry about how drunk I'm getting because he'll take care of me. And maybe you shouldn't, you know, assume that. She didn't know him that long. It's not like they were together for years or anything like that. But even in cases like that, things can happen. So anyway, from what I, the information I got was something had happened with the key to her. It either was a dorm or a house, like a fraternity house or something like that. So they had went to his house. Now, he was driving her. She had a Mercedes. And this also comes into play as well, that she sounds like, and I didn't hear if she's from the area, but that she must have a lot of money. Her parents must have a lot of money. If she's driving around in a Mercedes and she's in college, obviously she's not making money to drive around in a Mercedes. So this could have been a family that was came, you know, that really pushed this case, that donated to the school. So people don't think about these things. They want to compare cases and say, well, this happened here and this happened here, but they don't want to look at the individual circumstances. And I don't know that to be the case, but if she's driving a Mercedes, I would assume that she comes from money. She was 21 years old, or she is. She's still alive, luckily. Not that anything happened that would have killed her, besides alcohol poisoning. That's another thing, too. I mean, this is not just about, and somebody was saying this, I think it was Dr. Drew, and people got mad at him for it, that this is not just about women being sexually assaulted. This is also about alcohol. And my cousin went to UMass Amherst and almost died from alcohol poisoning at some party. And she was actually naked. They had pictures of her naked in a bathtub. Now, why she was naked, I don't know. The reason they had her in a bathtub and they had her face down, like in case she threw up. But why would you put somebody in a bathtub? I don't know. I remember her telling me the story. I mean, this happened 20 years ago and she's fine, but who knows what had happened up to that point. So I actually should have got in contact with her before the show and asked her about it, what she remembered about it, because again, this was like 20 years ago. But anyway, that had happened as well. And alcohol, you can die from alcohol poisoning. So this isn't a joke. It's not just about the sexual assault side of it. It's also about the danger that these girls, especially, you know, a lot of them are little, you know, skinny girls drinking ridiculous amounts of shots. And if you're drinking enough to pass out, if you throw up in your sleep, you can die. So college kids need to be careful about that, both women and men. So what happened was, before I get into the specifics on what happened, the reason why anybody even found out about this is there was a door, and I think it was from them, from him and some of the players cracking a door. So there was a cracked door, and they went to the cameras to see how did this door get cracked. And they went through a whole bunch of footage because there's cameras all over the place, security. And this is what they ended up seeing. They saw I saw some of this footage. The car pulled up. So she ended up passing out. He ran into some of his, I don't know that they were his friends, but guys he knew on the team. They were outside at the dorm. They helped carry her in. But they were kind of like fucking around, like they dropped her. They like, it's like they were making a joke out of it. You know, at first he's just carrying her like he would if she was, passed out. And I mean, that's really what should have happened is it would have been no problem if she passed out. He carried her to his room and, you know, didn't let anybody in there and let her, you know, sleep. And then didn't do anything, obviously, to her. And then that's the end of it. And when she woke up, she woke up. So, but unfortunately, that's not what happened. They brought her, you know, you could see the footage. It's kind of like they were fucking around in nothing serious yet, but, you know, it just wasn't right. So they brought her to his room, and there were three other players that came in the room. Now, she was totally passed out. And what happened was they took out their phones and they started filming, and they did stuff to her where they put things inside of her. I don't believe anybody actually had intercourse with her, but I've heard something about them, somebody, you know, putting his penis either in her mouth or near it or something like that. And they filmed all of this stuff. So he had also sent it, Brandon, to two of his friends in California, I guess, where he was from. So she wakes up in the morning. He lies and says that he took care of her, that she passed out, and that was it. And later, of course, she finds out, you know, what happened. But the next day, that day, he actually had sex with her. So they were dating, I guess, and she had even said to the police that he wouldn't do anything to hurt her. So, obviously, before she found anything out, she even had sex with him. And I guess he didn't do anything to her, I don't believe, except film, but that's still, you know, he's the one who brought her in the room and let them do that. So I guess he's still an accomplice to that. And all four of them ended up being charged, as they should have. But what happened was, and this is kind of one of the saddest parts, is she didn't know what happened. She didn't remember. Like I said, she had sex with him the next day. And she was shown the videos by the police eventually. And I think this went on for a while. They talked to all the players because they had shown some of the players, and the players, I guess, told the police, not all of them, but one or two of them that didn't cover up for them, that they were shown videos and they somehow got a copy of somebody's video. And that's how they got the evidence. And then they showed her and she said that she didn't remember any of that. And that's where for her to had trusted him like that and for him to let them take advantage of her is just, it's really fucked up. So all four of them were charged. Two of them, as far as I know, haven't gone to trial yet. And Brandon and this other guy, Corey Beatty, both got 50. I believe, actually, I don't believe they got sentenced, but they're facing 15 to 25 years. Now, what a lot of, and this is what I don't get, and maybe there's something I'm missing here. Brandon, the one who brought the girl in, is white, and Corey Beatty is black. And they're both facing the same time. But Brock Turner at Stanford, who only got 6 months, they're comparing him to Corey Beatty, but they're not mentioning Brandon at all, even though he's facing 15 to 25 years. Now, I could have missed something and they could have both been sentenced and maybe Brandon didn't get as much time because he pretty much just filmed, although he was the one who it wouldn't have happened if it wasn't for him in the first place. I mean, he's the one who brought them in the room. He's the one who let them do what they had done. You know, it's fucked up. So they're leaving him out. So they're trying to say that, well, look what happens. This is white privilege. When a white kid does it, he gets 6 months. When a black kid does it, he gets 15 to 25 years. And I don't think either of them have been sentenced because they were on trial together and they're both facing the 15 to 25 years. So that's kind of fucked up that they're totally leaving him out. And that's where I had mentioned that you have to remember that they're in a different state, which totally changes things. You might think it doesn't, but it does. And what they did was not the same thing as what this Brock Turner did. It was a lot worse. I mean, they were degrading her. Not to say that if a woman's passed out and you have sex with her, that's not degrading. But, I mean, they were putting things inside her and just doing all kinds of, and I don't even know everything that they did because I didn't see that part of the video. They didn't show it. I just know what they had mentioned in the videos that I listened to. So I think that's an unfair comparison there to make, to say that, well, that's why, because I don't believe that is why. Plus, you also have the other guy as well that I believe they'll be sentenced to the same amount of time. Now, again, I could have missed something and they could have both been sentenced already and he could have got more time, but I didn't find anything that said that either of them had been sentenced yet. So I'll have to see what happens on that. But those are both terrible cases that, especially in the Vanderbilt, you know, the girl thought she was with someone that she was dating that she could trust. And it turns out, you know, that's not to mention what happened to her, but the fact that how can she trust anybody again like that, you know, because of what happened? Her trust of anybody is going to be affected. So I have three cases regarding men being falsely accused, and let me go through those real quick. I think that most people are familiar with these. And if they're not, then obviously you'll hear about them now. But there are cases where women make false allegations as well. And it's not even false allegations per se, I think, a lot of the time. I think it's not knowing. Or was I raped? Was that rape? Was I too drunk to make a decision? Because there were girls saying, not documentary, but just in other videos, that, well, if a girl is drunk at all and she has sex with somebody, then that's rape. So how many of these are situations where the girl consents, but they feel that she was too drunk to consent, and they're calling that rape, or the girl herself is calling that rape? Now, to me, it really depends. I think for the most part, it's not rape, because you don't know the mind state of that person. You don't know if they're, I mean, if you can easily tell that they're just totally out of it. But usually the guy's drinking too. And as I was saying earlier, it's hard to measure how drunk somebody is. And then if you're drunk too, and as long as they're consenting, I don't see anything wrong with that. And I think that's the majority of what they're saying is not being recognized, or the guys are not getting in trouble for. Because at the same time, what if a girl's sober and a guy's drunk, and the girl's not going to get in trouble for that? But of course, if it's the reverse, the guy will. Now, I would say if a guy's sober and a girl's really drunk, that it's morally not the right thing to do. It depends. I mean, if it's your girlfriend and you had sex with her before, that's different. But if that's the first time that you're with that girl, I would say morally it's probably not the right thing to do. If she's consenting and, you know, she can walk and she's not, you know, falling over drunk, then I don't know that there's something wrong with that. It depends. It depends on the level of how drunk they are, and it depends on the level of how drunk the guy is too, because he's not going to be able to process how drunk she is if he's pretty drunk himself. But in these situations, it has nothing to do with anything like that. It's just straight up lying. So, of course, the Duke lacrosse team in 2006, I think that's a story that most people know about, where they had a stripper over. And the stripper claimed she was raped in the bathroom. And then she went through pictures of all of the guys there. First of all, they found no DNA at all. They found DNA belonging to, I guess, 11 other guys. None of them had any were players of the lacrosse team. And the DA, who was sued later, I think he was thrown out of an office and got in a lot of trouble because he would not drop the case, even when he knew that they were innocent. He would not drop the case. He kept pushing. And at the end, of course, three members were charged and the case was dropped. So it became about this DA and him wanting to push these charges and find somebody guilty, really. And I think the reasons they gave for the stripper lying, it was something about her kids were, she also went to school there, but something with her kids, and she didn't want to get in even more trouble with CPS or something like that. Or I remember hearing some stuff like that as to the reason why, but who knows? And they had to go through, their season got canceled. Of course, you have the three members who got charged. And it was kind of, again, it was just, they showed video of her just going through the pictures of everybody and then picking them out. There was no physical evidence, nothing. And it was just them having a party where they invited a stripper over to strip. And then her claiming rape after the fact. So that was a big story. And that was, I even remember hearing about that. It doesn't seem like it was that long ago, but it was. It's been 10 years already. So they had actually made one of those ESPN 30 for 30 documentaries on it as well. And I got a lot of information from that. Then there was one at the University of Virginia. And this was, from what I understood with this, it was written in Rolling Stone magazine. There was an article that at a frat that a girl was brought there by her date. She was told that there was going to be a party there. And she claims that she was raped by her date and seven other guys, and or her date watched while she was raped by seven other guys. And this was, again, in Rolling Stone magazine. I think what happened was it was in there first, and then the police then investigated it. So it wasn't like she went to the police. It was she went to somehow, I don't know how she would, maybe she knew somebody at Rolling Stone. I don't know how it got to Rolling Stone, but none of her, the police investigated it thoroughly. Nothing added up. Her stories didn't, they conflicted with every other story that the police were told, or every other piece of information the police were told. They investigated that fraternity. They even investigated other fraternities as well. And in the end, nothing matched up. There was no evidence, nothing. And they asked, well, are you going to charge her with filing a false complaint? And they, of course, you know, said no. Maybe, you know, I don't know. And maybe this was a girl that was mentally ill. They never said who she was. She didn't give any other interviews that I'm aware of. And maybe the girl was nuts. I don't know. I actually have a YouTube clip of that that we can play real quick if I can find it. I just don't know what it's named, but the story for that, I don't know if there was a documentary on that or not, but I remember what I had seen on that, that there was a lot of, there was a huge investigation on that, that they were very thorough, even, like I said, after, they didn't even just investigate the frat that she had given them. They investigated other ones and followed other leads as well. So here is the clip on that.
New questions and doubts are being raised about the story of an alleged gang rape at the University of Virginia, an account that grabbed national attention, including ours. The story, first published in Rolling Stone, detailed the alleged brutal rape of a freshman at a fraternity house 2 years ago. The victim said she was assaulted by seven men over 3 hours while two others watched, including her reported date. After questions emerged, Rolling Stone's managing editor published a note today about discrepancies in the victim's story. He wrote, quote, "We have come to the conclusion that our trust in her was misplaced." The fraternity, Phi Kappa Psi, disputed parts of her story and said there was no social event at the house on the night in question. Well, we invited Rolling Stone and the reporter, whom we interviewed before about this, to appear tonight. We also invited the University of Virginia. All declined. But reporter Taylor Reese Shapiro broke part of this story for the Washington Post. He joins me from a university studio in Charlottesville, and we welcome you to the program. Taylor Reese Shapiro, this is a horrific story as it was first reported. What parts of the alleged victim's account have now been called into question?
What has been called into question are the dates. First of all, the date that she said that it had occurred. She said that it occurred on September 28, 2012, which would have been pretty early on into her freshman year on campus. The fraternity today released a statement saying that, in fact, they had not hosted any parties that entire weekend, which would immediately call into question the timing of what she had said the allegations had occurred. In addition, it's not clear precisely who was among her alleged attackers. She had said for years even, you know, since from the very beginning, that she had identified one of the men that she believed was involved, that, in fact, that they were somebody that they, that she had been dating him, or, you know, had gone out on a date with him. When pressed, and she finally gave up a name to her friends about who it was, some digging into his background, you know, initially raised some, you know, questions about her account because things didn't line up. It appeared that the person involved was, in fact, never a member of Phi Kappa Psi, and other details about his background didn't match other previously released information that she had given people.
Well, now, you talked to her several times, you wrote, in your story. How is she explaining these discrepancies?
She sticks by her story. She believes that the account of what she gave is the truth. I gave her multiple opportunities in interviews to tell me the real events as they had actually occurred that night. It's impossible to tell, from what we know now, what really did happen. It appears pretty clear that she faced some sort of trauma. I can't say for sure. But other details as they emerge are calling into question other parts of her story.
Now, you also talked with her friends, other people who knew her at the time this happened, and what are they saying?
Her friends are devastated. I think a lot of people are about everything. It's hard to know what to believe. It's pretty clear now that details related in the first article, you know, did not line up with stuff that's pretty easy to check out, such as the fact whether or not a party was held at that house that weekend. From now, it's about building trust. It's about building trust between her and other people around her, and about the people who trusted her to tell them for her to tell them the true story.
What about the fraternity? They were asked, I gather, by Rolling Stone months ago about this, starting months ago, and it wasn't until just today that they put out a statement saying, you know, as you said, that the date, there wasn't a social event that night and so forth. Do you have a better sense of their perspective in this?
I've spoken with members of the fraternity throughout my reporting. You know, we reached out to them from the very beginning because we wanted to make sure that we got all sides of the story. They were hard-pressed. Few people actually talked to us on the phone, and if they did, you know, they just said they didn't want to comment. Obviously, you know, they were under fire. They were under pressure. Since then, people have already come forward to me saying that they feel, you know, relief. They had even begun to doubt themselves. It's hard to say, you know, that you know everything that goes on in a fraternity house any weekend. But they now feel some sense of validity that, you know, their side was the truth from the very beginning.
What happens now at the university? Are they investigating? We know from other reporting there were other rapes that reportedly have taken place. Other students have given accounts of that at the university. Are those investigations continuing? What is the university saying going forward?
It's pretty clear that this article and other allegations from this resulted in some serious, you know, sort of soul-searching here at the University of Virginia for good reason. Sexual assault is a serious problem on college campuses everywhere. And I think that they, from the very beginning, said that they needed to address it. Regardless of the facts of this specific incident, I think that the need for them to address these issues on the campus, you know, still exists.
Now, you also talked to other women who said they were sexually assaulted at the University of Virginia, some of them expressing concern that the unraveling of this story is going to have an effect on how seriously people take sexual assault on campus. What are they saying?
They're saying, again, that it's about trust on the campus. In order for victims and survivors of sexual assault to feel comfortable to come forward, they need to feel that they're in an environment where they will be welcomed, where their story will be, you know, treated as credible. Obviously, you know, when instances where sexual assault allegations don't hold up to the facts, you know, that in part discredits other people who want to come forward. At the same time, you know, they are all about moving forward and encouraging others to come forward with their stories because it's so crucial to address this national issue on college campuses.
Taylor Reese Shapiro with The Washington Post. We thank you.
Thank you.
The statistics, nothing short of...
So, in that case, and, you know, I agree with kind of what they said at the end there, that they should obviously take each case seriously, and you don't want a case to deter women from coming forward. But if the facts don't line up, then obviously they're not going to move forward with something. So I would hope that something like that would deter false stories from coming forward, that if you are going to lie and make something up, that they're going to find out about it. But if you're telling the truth, then you have nothing to worry about. And it's hard to really make people feel comfortable or uncomfortable in the case of lying, and it depends on the school and the trust and reputation and things like that. And I can imagine for a girl that's been raped, for her to come forward, for it to be very hard for her to do that. And that's where they're saying there have been allegations at a lot of schools, and this was in the documentary The Hunting Ground, where they, you know, made comments or, you know, negative comments or derogatory comments that the girls that filed the reports felt, that things like, you know, what were you wearing or stuff like that. And I think, you know, getting into things like that is fucked up. Now, the drinking part of it is something I think that is a factor when you're investigating these things, because it is going to affect your memory. And that's where I do believe that if you got rid of these fraternity parties. Now, I don't believe, I of course believe in freedom, so I don't think that the colleges should get rid of fraternity parties. But if girls didn't go, then they wouldn't have them. Or having sororities have their own parties and having them or giving them more of the control where they're already at. Most of the girls, at least, would already be at where they live, and they would have more control. They could have security and things like that, because the fraternities are setting it up for the purpose of hooking up with girls. I mean, that's what they're doing. And I think that's obvious. But I did make a statement earlier, too, that there may be some girls that are going to fraternity parties because they want to hook up with guys as well. One thing that people got to remember, and I'm not talking about girls that are claiming they're being raped or anything like that or assaulted. I'm just claiming or talking about girls in general that want to hook up with guys. I mean, there are girls want to hook up with guys as well. So there are girls that may be going to fraternity parties to hook up with guys. And they go and they hook up with guys and, you know, whatever. That's what happens, happens. And to look at these girls, I mentioned this yesterday, as just, you know, they're all innocent little sweet girls that don't have sex or don't, you know, do any of that is not the case neither. That doesn't mean that these allegations aren't true, or it doesn't mean that girls aren't sexually assaulted, because they are. But what I'm saying is that it's not like girls don't want to have sex at times, and obviously with the right, you know, right person, the person they want to have sex with, they obviously don't want to be raped or sexually assaulted. If they want to have sex, they want to have sex with the person that they want to have sex with. But there is that sexual element on both sides, is what I'm saying. And I don't think it's recognized on the girl side that it's just the fraternity that is setting up a party to hook up, and none of the girls that go there with the intention to hook up with guys. You know, some of them I'm sure don't, and some of them do. But there are girls that do. So I wanted to, I'll briefly get into one more story, and then we'll get into rape culture and things for tonight. But there was the mattress girl, and from the information I got, that there was enough information that came out showing that mattress girl was mad at her boyfriend. I believe they may have been into some weird kind of sex, but they were actually dating. They were boyfriend and girlfriend. She released text messages, or text messages got released, and I believe this was even after the allegations. And this is what proved essentially that her allegations were fake. And he sued her based on Title IX as well and the false accusations, because he obviously looked like, you know, a rapist. She's walking around with this bed. And the conclusion I would come to from what I have heard, because they mentioned other girls as well, is that he was into some rough sex. And from what I got from her is, you know, they were together and she was into that too. Not that he was a rapist or forced her to do anything. And that what had come out from her and her text messages essentially proved that. So that turned into a project for her also, where she got credit for carrying around a fucking mattress. And, you know, some girls just want attention. And I saw an interview with her, and I could sense that she was that type of girl that wants attention. And I guess they have both graduated, so it really doesn't mean much now. I know the suit was dismissed, but there was something where the judge said that he could refile it. So I don't know exactly what's going on with that. But that's that whole thing is just it's like a train wreck. That was just weird. I know she filmed what had happened or something, and in her house, and there was all sorts of things that were going on with that. And but it came out, at least enough information came out, it seemed, that proved that her allegations were not true, that he did not rape her. And again, that was, you know, I don't know how long they were together for, but they were boyfriend and girlfriend. So regarding rape culture, and this is something that feminists are really pushing. The definition I got was rape culture is an environment in which rape is prevalent and in which sexual violence against women is normalized and excused in the media and popular culture. Rape culture is perpetrated through the use of misogynistic language, the objectification of women's bodies, and the glamorization of sexual violence, thereby creating a society that disregards women's rights and safety. And, you know, I don't, one, believe that there is an unconsensual environment like that. I mean, I think of, you know, there's people that are into some weird sexual shit and it's consensual. But as far as the objectification of women's bodies, and this is, I think, where a lot of people disagree, looking at a woman and, you know, that's dressed sexy and, you know, looking at her, you know, thinking she looks sexy. I mean, I don't think there's anything wrong with that. Yeah, obviously, if somebody acts on that and sexually assaults her, that's a whole nother story. But to say that women dressing up or looking beautiful or glamorizing them looking beautiful is some kind of or part of rape culture, and that seems like what they're trying to do, it to me is a bunch of bullshit. And it also says that rape culture affects every woman. The rape of one woman is a degradation, terror, and limitation to all women. Most women and girls limit their behavior because of the existence of rape, where most women and girls live in fear of rape. Men in general do not. That's how rape functions, as a powerful means by which the whole female population is held in a subordinate position to the whole male population. Even though many men don't rape and many women are never victims of rape, the cycle of fear is the legacy of rape culture. And I understand what they're saying by that. It's kind of the what they're saying with what women can't drink that much and pass out and men can. And I would say that men to drink that much and pass out is not a good idea or something that they should do neither. Because never mind, you know, they could get raped, but they could get robbed. Other things could happen. Just because it's not rape does not mean that they shouldn't follow the same sort of rules when it comes to alcohol, because for the most part, they should. I mean, you shouldn't be that drunk by yourself where you're, you know, passing out drunk. And that goes for anybody. So I don't think that saying that drinking leaves them, that things can happen when they're drunk where they could be sexually assaulted, but other things could happen as well, that goes along with rape culture, because I don't think men should be getting blackout drunk or passing out drunk neither, because a lot of other things could happen. So that's where they go into, you know, examples, blaming the victim, sexually explicit jokes, tolerance of sexual harassment. I don't think anybody, you know, in general believes in most of this shit, like the tolerance of sexual harassment or trivializing sexual assault or blaming the victim. I'm sure there are people here and there that have that fucked up attitude. I mean, you're going to come across every type of person there is, but the majority of people do not feel that way. They do not feel that rape is okay. They do not feel that it is okay to sexually harass somebody or trivialize sexual assault or blame the victim or any of those things. And I think some of these that they throw in there are not, I wouldn't consider rape culture. One of them, they said pressure on men to score, like when, you know, teenagers and college kids, if they're still virgins, people will put pressure on, oh, you haven't had sex yet. Is that rape culture? Is that trying to influence them to rape somebody? You know, so I think some of these things that are in here have nothing to do with a rape. And we only have a couple minutes left, so I want to play this one last clip about the woman in Nevada that I kept mentioning and how she was raped because she didn't have her gun with her. And she had a permit to carry at University of Reno and had a gun put to her head, but of course followed the law and didn't carry her gun.
Right now, Arizona lawmakers approving a landmark bill that allows guns on college and university campuses. Why? Claudia Cowan is live in San Francisco with some possibilities. Claudia?
Well, John, we're talking about Amanda Collins in Reno, Nevada. She has a permit to carry a concealed weapon for her safety only, not at her school, the University of Nevada at Reno, because like most public colleges, it is a gun-free zone. But that meant nothing to the serial rapist who attacked Amanda on campus, turning her first into a victim and now into a crusader.
He put a firearm to my temple, clicked off the safety, and told me not to say anything before he raped me.
Without her gun, Amanda says she was rendered defenseless. Amanda says additional call boxes and better lights won't stop an attacker who knows this is a gun-free zone, a policy she believes emboldened the man who raped her. Just weeks later, James Bila went on to murder 19-year-old Brianna Dennison and is now on death row.
Had SB 231 been the current law on October 22, 2007, Brianna Dennison would still be alive today.
Amanda hopes her terrifying ordeal will persuade Nevada lawmakers to pass legislation allowing concealed weapons on campus. But critics like State Senator Michael Schneider fear lifting campus gun bans will only lead to more tragedy.
I just think it creates an atmosphere that is actually an unsafe atmosphere. It makes people nervous.
The criminals who are intent on committing a crime anyways don't care about what the rules and regulations are. The only people that do are the law-abiding citizens, and those are the ones who are permitted to carry everywhere else.
Right now, 13 states are debating whether to lift these campus gun bans. Amanda says as painful as it is for her to relive her attack, she will testify in other states to help make that happen. John?
Claudia Cowan live from San Francisco.
And unfortunately, that didn't happen. They didn't lift the ban after that happened, and I wish that they did. And I support our two big universities, University of Nevada, Reno, and University of Nevada, Las Vegas. Especially, I support wearing their jerseys, as I have a bunch of them. And I was a UNLV season ticket holder. I didn't get season tickets this year, but I probably will next year. But I do support the schools, and I'm troubled that that didn't go through. But thanks, everybody, for listening. That's all the time we have for tonight. But we will be back on Tuesday. So I hope everybody has a nice holiday, and we'll see you then. Thanks, everybody. NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com. Check us out.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it.